Hey, what's up everybody? Dr. Rossi, strengthsandsneakers.com. So I realized the other day I made a video discussing California rocket fuel, but I really didn't do a good job setting the context for that discussion, right? Because you might be asking yourself, well, all these talk about neurotransmitters and combining fancy drugs together to get a response to people's depression makes sense, but where does this theory come from? What is the biochemical theory of depression? So in this video, I'm going to talk about the history of the biochemical theory for depression and where some of these ideas come from. So many times in casual conversation, I'll encounter somebody who will say, yeah, depression, it's a chemical imbalance. So where does this idea of a chemical imbalance come from? Well, it's very intuitive, right? And it's a nice way to explain depression. You have a deficiency of serotonin. If we increase your serotonin levels, you no longer feel depressed, right? I wish it was that simple, because obviously in clinical practice it's not. However, this is sort of the idea. So where does that come from? So the prevailing theory that we're talking about in this video is called the biogenic amine hypothesis. So complicated terms, big words, what does it mean? So basically a biogenic amine is things like serotonin would be one example. So that's a familiar one that most people should know. Norepinephrine, which I talked about in the California rocket fuel video, and dopamine. So those are kind of the big three I'll talk about. There's others such as histamine, and they do play a role, but let's just focus on the ones that are most commonly used in drug design today. So that's the current prevailing theory. Where does it come from though? Where did people kind of observe, or what did they observe that led them to believe increasing serotonin or norepinephrine or dopamine in the brain would lead to improved moods? Well, it actually comes from research in a different area of medicine. Okay, so they were looking for drugs to treat tuberculosis, and they came up with a drug called iperniazide, which is similar to isoniazide, a common drug still used to treat tuberculosis today. But iperniazide, what they found was it was a horrible drug for treating the person's tuberculosis. So many of these patients didn't do well from a standpoint of the actual infection. However, what they noticed with these people, these patients that were being tested with this drug, was that their mood was enhanced. They actually felt better. They were less depressed despite their circumstances. So they weren't getting better physically, but they were getting happier, and then people couldn't understand why. So that led to the question, what was it about this drug that was causing these people to feel better despite not being better physically? And what they found was iperniazide is actually an MAOI inhibitor. So monoamine oxidase inhibitor. Again, another complicated word. I don't want to get too bogged down because I'm trying to make this educational for everybody and not just people who are in the field of medicine. But MAOI inhibitor is going to prevent the breakdown of things like serotonin, dopamine, norepinephrine, right? It's going to prevent the breakdown of these neurotransmitters so that more of it will be available for the brain, right? More of it will be available to bind to receptors. So that's the class of medication. And ultimately, that became the first antidepressants. There's some debate about which antidepressant came first. Was it MAOI inhibitors, or was it tricyclic antidepressants? But the truth is, the answer is MAOIs were the first antidepressants. And it came from this research looking at a drug to treat tuberculosis. So that's one of the ways in which we started to come up with a biochemical theory for depression. Hey, if we inhibit this monoamine oxidase inhibitor, if we use this drug, we inhibit this enzyme from breaking down these serotonin and norepinephrine, dopamine, etc., we find that people's mood improves. So there must be something about having higher levels of these neurotransmitters that leads to a benefit in depression and lifts the depression. Further support actually comes from a theory involving animal studies, which is usually the way a lot of this stuff works, right? It starts with animal studies and then evolves later to human studies. And that involved the tricyclic antidepressants, which would be probably the second class of medication that came along to treat depression. And what they found with these drugs was that these medications blocked the reuptake of both serotonin and norepinephrine. So similar to what I talked about in my previous video on California rocket fuel, where you're getting that same effect with drugs like venlafaxine, you were getting it with the tricyclic antidepressants. Now, those drugs have since kind of moved off the market. They're still available, but most practitioners are not prescribing them, which is somewhat of a tragedy because I think everybody should have a well-versed psychopharmacology understanding and be able to use not only the more modern drugs, but also, you know, the older drugs. And we can talk in future videos about MAOI inhibitors and how they may be one of the most effective and underutilized antidepressants that we have. So that's kind of where some of this support comes from. Again, it increases these neurotransmitters. There's something about that that helps patients with depression. So what are the problems with this theory, right? A couple of things that I can see that are very obvious and will probably be obvious to you at this point is that while yes, these medications start working immediately, meaning if they're blocking serotonin reuptake or norepinephrine reuptake, it happens immediately, but the effects on depression take weeks, sometimes somewhere in the range of 4 to 6 weeks, depending on the patient, to start to see an antidepressant effect. So what is the story there? So what we've come up with is that maybe it's the result of the downregulation of the receptors after they bind all of this extra serotonin and norepinephrine, right? Well, there's also problems with that theory, right? It's unlikely to fully explain the antidepressant effects of the medication. However, this remains the prevailing theory, and it is the basis for a lot of the drug design, even the current drug design that's going on now. We're only beginning to start to see new options for treatment of depression, things such as ketamine, which is an NMDA receptor antagonist, which is a different mechanism. So we're starting to see new things, but a lot of the common drugs, a lot of the ones you're going to be either prescribed or familiar with, are going to work in this way. So what are my final points? The biogenic amine hypothesis is just a hypothesis, right? If you've studied any type of science at any level, you'll know what a hypothesis is and that this is not necessarily a full-blown guaranteed fact. It's a theory. It provides us a basis from which to work. And most of the early evidence that we have, such as the description I gave you guys about the iproniazid medication in tuberculosis, it's observational evidence, meaning that we initially found out that these medications helped people with their depression by observing how they reacted to the medication when they took it. We're not necessarily doing rigorous controlled trials at the time, although since then, obviously those trials have been conducted, and I do believe these medications, based on the evidence, are better than placebo and do help in the treatment of depression. So while this biogenic amine hypothesis is incomplete and doesn't fully explain why people become depressed, it does provide us a useful framework for future study and drug design. So that concludes the video on the biogenic amine hypothesis. Hopefully this provides you a basis for understanding how these drugs work. And if you have any questions, leave them in the comments section. And please like and subscribe to the videos. It helps us to continue to make content for you guys. And if you want more information on this, I have a whole blog post that details way more of the facts associated with this biogenic amine hypothesis.